Well, hello again, nerds! Welcome to yet another episode of the Nerd Reacts, or A Nerd Reacts, I guess is how I've been labeling these recently. This is King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard. First time we're doing reaction to this, not the first time I've heard this band, the first time I've heard this song. We'll get into that and all of the things in just a second. Well, hello there, nerds. Thank you very much for joining me for this reaction video. We have a couple of things to get out of the way before we can get back to said video. First and foremost, I do reactions as more of an initial analysis. So we're going to be stopping this. We're going to be talking over certain things. We're going to be replaying sections. We're going to be doing a lot of things that are not conducive to somebody who just wants to watch the original content. If you would rather watch the original content uninterrupted, then please go do that. I definitely would recommend that before you join me here on this reaction and analysis. Beyond that, I have to get my qualifications out of the way. I have been training in music since I was a little kid, which means approximately 30 years. I have been a professional musician and studio producer for about 20 of those 30 years. I have also been making, directing, and editing music videos and YouTube content for over a decade at this point. So I have a base of knowledge that lends itself to adding something constructive to this conversation. And that is exactly what this is. This is a conversation. This is my interpretation of what we are about to react to and analyze. If you have a different interpretation, that's what the comment section is for. Let's have a conversation about this thing, about why it may or may not be the greatest thing ever, whatever it is. I welcome the comments. I do request, though, that you try and be constructive with your criticism, or you at least have some sort of knowledge base to work from, because gotcha moments are not going to work in this comment section. I do have a pretty strong knowledge base and a pretty strong opinion most of the time. So, all of that being said, thank you very much for joining me right now, and let's get back to your regularly scheduled reaction video. Okay, so King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard. There's a funny little story about the name of this band while I'm pulling up their information. So I play with a band that is kind of multiple bands all at once. The band I play with is called Telepathic Sandwich. Telepathic Sandwich was started by two guys I've known for some time, and a friend of ours who is a multi-instrumentalist, kind of brilliant musician who has weird stage fright, so we don't play very often, but play live anyway. We have like 7 records of music that I'm still trying to kick our bass player in the ass enough to actually publish, but that's a whole different thing. So the primary iteration of this band is technically a different band called Orifice A. Orifice A is just Stefan and Abe and our drummer Skip, and they're not so much anymore, getting older, views on the world are changing and stuff, but they used to do a lot of drugs. I don't know, being the sober kid all the time, I don't know how I always have a bunch of party and friends, but that's kind of the way it's worked out in my life. But so when they did the drugs, when they would do certain psychedelics, Abe would get really stuck on words. And so the words that he would get stuck on a lot would be words with the izzard in the middle of it, at the end of the word. So there is an Orifice A song that predates, I'm pretty sure, let's see, now that I'm looking at the information, formed in 2010. So maybe not predates the band itself, but predates our knowledge of the band King Gizzard. There is an Orifice A song called Lizard Wizard that is basically just about them doing psychedelics. And it's really funny because, like, it was probably 2-3 years after that song was written and recorded that we heard of King Gizzard and Lizard Wizard. So that's my personal, like, that's kind of close, a personal association that I have. That's not really an association with the band at all, but just a fun little thing that is a part of my life that I always associate with this band. So King Gizzard, the bit that I know before we read this bit of Wikipedia. King Gizzard is a band that is insanely prolific in their output, which is why we don't really talk about them much on the channel. It makes it very difficult for me to cover their output because they literally put out like 2 to 3 records a year, sometimes a month. So and their output is all over the place as far as genre goes. So it makes it difficult for a once a week news program to say, because I would have to do a once a week King Gizzard video in order to cover their output. I do work with a guy who is a Gizzard fan, like hardcore Gizzard fan, and is doing his damnedest to collect as much as possible of the music that they have put out, and follows them pretty religiously, and recently saw them, and it won't shut up about this new record. New record is supposed to be a metal record. This is the second or third time they've ventured into this genre, so it's not like they're newbies to it at all. Generally speaking, it is definitely psychedelic rock. Garage rock is probably a good way to put it as well, which now I'm just reading the Wikipedia, so let's go into that. This is the history of the band, at least as far as the first couple paragraphs of Wikipedia are concerned. So we have, according to Wikipedia, King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard are an Australian rock band formed in 2010 in Melbourne, Victoria. Band's current lineup consists of Stu Mackenzie, Ambrose Kenny-Smith, Cook Craig, Joey Walker, Lucas Harwood, and Michael Cavanagh. They are known for exploring multiple genres, staging energetic live shows, and building a prolific discography. Having released 24 studio albums since 2010, mind you, 24 studio albums, 15 live albums, 5 compilations, 3 EPs, and 1 remix album. Their second EP, Willoughby's Beach, and debut album, 12 Bar Brews, primarily blended surf music and garage rock, and were released on Flightless, the band's own label. Their second album, a psychedelic spaghetti western titled Eyes Like the Sky. Wow, I feel like I've heard Kyle talk about that stuff, but this is all funny new stuff to me. Features spoken word narration by Broderick Smith, father of band member Ambrose Kenny-Smith, Float Along, Fill Your Lungs, released later in that year, and the 2014 albums Oddments and I'm In Your Mind Fuzz saw the band expand their psychedelic sound. In 2015, they drew on elements of jazz fusion and progressive rock with Quarters, and also released folk-inspired papier-mâché Dream Balloon, recorded almost entirely using acoustic instruments. Nonagon Infinity features 9 interconnected tracks that form an infinite loop and won the ARIA Award for Best Hard Rock and Heavy Metal Album. So that was their first metal exploration, it would seem. And then it goes on, and we're not going to read the entire thing, but yeah, that kind of gives you an idea of where we are. And also that kind of reverses, I already gave you my history with the band. That's about all I've got. So let's get into expectations. I expect this to be like proggy metal stuff. I don't expect this to be like crazy heavy with the screaming and the deathcore and that kind of metal that we generally do reactions to on this channel. And generally the kind of metal that I listen to the most. So yeah, that's what we got. I think that's all of the pre-bits. Oh no, expectations. We're doing expectations. So expectations are prog. Expectations are I don't even know how long the song is. Let's take a look at that real quick. Song is 10 minutes long. Fun. I did not anticipate that. So, yeah. It's going to be a trudge. A trek. That's the word I was looking for. It's going to be a trek. So, let's, without any much more ado, let's do that. Oh, we have to, sorry, pushing buttons in the wrong order. We're going here, and then we go... and then we go here. All right, here we go. Trigger warning, seizure warning, I guess. Do not watch this video. This is like almost Mastodon-y kind of feel to it. I really dig that. That's really cool. This very like 70s aesthetic situation going on here. That's really fun. I really like the like 70s special effects. And obviously we're shooting black and white, and they already have that kind of 70s kind of psychedelic vibe going for the band. So sticking with it, even with the metal stuff, that's cool. Wow. I really dig. All right, so let's take a look at this. So modern production, we've talked about this previously. Modern production, especially for drums, is pretty reliant on reverb. Drums and vocals, primarily, excuse me. So the fact that we have only verb on the vocals, just because of the psychedelia element, that was to be expected, but there's no verb on any of these drums. This is a very intimate drum tone, and interesting that, and there's no chorus effect or anything, and it sounds like we have a microphone that is right up next to the beaters on the kick drum, so you're getting a lot of the impact noise and not as much of the resonating noise, and that is such an interesting tone. I dig it. Big thing that usually gets verb too is the snare. You verb out your snare and your kick drum, is what I was taught in school. But in practice, more often what we've been doing is just verb out the entire kit with one verb. You have the drum kit run through its own submix, and that submix gets a verb effect onto it. But from what's quote unquote the standard, you put on the primarily on the snare and the kick, because those are the two punctuating drums and those are the two that are kind of constantly there. So it gives your kit, your drum kit, more of a room sound, so it feels like you're in the room with the drums, whereas doing it this way feels like you're sitting on the throne of the drums. So that's very interesting. What is that? That's... E, C, C, we're in C.
Iconic.
So the all right, let's talk about these vocals real quick. Definitely verby. There's a whole lot of reverb on there. Again, with the progressive kind of 70s psychedelia sound. I'm digging the riff. Sorry. Anyway, so the verb on this on these vocals, the production of the vocals is fine. I really like actually how it's being layered into the mix so that the vocals still sit on the top, but not so overpowering as to set them apart. So that's really nice. I really dig that. They've put out so much music. At this point, I would hope that they would have that kind of understanding of the sonic landscape that they're going for. But the performance rather of the vocals, what he's actually doing with his larynx and his vocal folds and all these, is like it comes across as somebody who has an appreciation for the genre but hasn't put in the work to get the sound he wants. So it almost seems like, and I understand that this is totally me being judgy, but whatever. It almost seems like a little kid listening to his dad's metal records and trying to emulate that sound without understanding their instrument in that way. I'm sure that Stu, I'm pretty sure was his name, I'm sure that he has a great understanding of his vocal instrument in general, but when it comes to this very specific genre and this kind of very specific like the gruff vocal kind of delivery, it's a very different way to look at your vocal instrument. So he's still approaching it from a traditional style, which again goes in line with the 70s psychedelia aspects, but is that we've learned a lot more about how to produce those gruff tones with your voice that I don't think he's bothered to learn. So again, it just kind of comes off as a little amateurish in performance, but not in production or anything else. And I'm going to get hung for that, but that's how it sounds. I'm sorry. Now we're in B. So, Oh no, we were in B the whole time. I'm dumb and I can't. I don't know words, whatever. I dig this. This is fun. It's almost like droney with the staccato. Yeah, this is cool. I really like the visuals, what's going on right now, too. This is really trippy. Now we've dropped out the bottom end entirely, all the instrumentation except for the drum. Oh, there we go. Listen to that. So this, oh, we're going back to that. We're going back to that. So that bass tone, that is pure bass tone, but there's something going on here that is worth noting. So a lot of modern aggressive styles of music, so not just metal, but like the proggy stuff and that kind of stuff too, oftentimes what will happen is there will be like a little bit of overdrive added to the bass just to kind of kick it up in the mix, sonically kind of give it its own area in the landscape, because it's difficult to to give it enough space to be heard when you're just dealing with the lower frequencies, because some people can't hear certain lower frequencies, can't hear frequencies below a certain point. And it also depends on the bass itself and kind of how low the bass player plays. And there's a number of factors there. So oftentimes kind of a thing to punch up bass is to add just a touch of overdrive to it. I'm a fan of this. I really like that sound. I have an overdrive pedal in my rig just kind of specifically for that. I don't really play a whole lot of purely clean bass on anything. This, though, is not that. This is just, this is a good example of something that I would have hated in my teenage years when I was cutting my teeth and doing music, which is playing with a pick. It increases the attack of the bass sound. It also increases kind of the tonal range. You get a little bit more of the mids and the high mids, and you can really hear that in this because it doesn't sound like there's any effects on it. It just sounds like dudes playing with a pick. And they're almost, I don't know what kind of pickups he's got, but the pickups seem very active. So it's picking up a lot of the pick noise on top of the actual string tone as well. So we're going to go back and listen to that a little bit. Oops, that's not what I meant to do. This. Right here. Here we go. Stop the track. Like, you can hear the bass hitting the string. It on mine because I'm playing distorted, but let's see if we can. That's not the one. That's kind of distorted as well. Don't I have a clean on here? I do not. Sorry, using an effects board that I haven't touched for months. But yeah, so if you pay attention to like the beginning of those notes, you can hear that pick noise, and it's definitely a valid reason to play with a pick. If you're going for a tone like that, you're going for a pickup like that without adding any extra effects, that's the way to do it. Oh, that's cool. That's really cool. So sonically and visually, this is great. We have a couple of effects going here. I don't know exactly how they're getting the bleed effect to happen, but basically oversaturated it into the black and white, so you have this highly contrasty stuff, which it looks like there's a number of ways they did it. It looks like there's a combination of lighting effects, so they have like a physical light underneath their face to kind of make these hard shadows, and then they made it even worse. You up the contrast, which gets rid of a lot of those middle kind of visual, those middle tones. And then whatever this bleed effect, I'm sure there's a number of ways to do this. And if I were to sit down and like figure it out for a couple of hours or an hour, even I could probably figure it out, but we don't have that kind of time. So just really cool, really effective. And I'm growing much more appreciative of this vocal style. It still seems like he could have done something if he had studied vocal technique for something more aggressive in this genre realm. There could be a more effective way to do what he's doing, but this is still pretty effective. I'm digging it a lot. See, it's a... Like I can't even, yeah, there it is. He's doing it in the back of his throat instead of in his chest and with his diaphragm. which if you are unaccustomed to the genre, that's kind of how you think that stuff's done. It's really not. Or there's other techniques that you do with your tongue to mask the sound and stuff. But still, it works with this. It works very well with this. Nice. Drummer's definitely great. See, and that's the other thing that kind of is why, I mean, obviously they're having fun and they enjoy what they do, but like this at the face that he's making. That is like this is goofy, this is fun, this is a genre that we're just dabbling in, obviously. I it's not really a complaint, it's just an observation. I really like that lick. Until the dragon. Like, it's almost like he's trying to emulate Lemmy with that vocal affectation, but it still feels like it's coming from, I don't know, it sounds like it's coming from his throat, not his chest. Sorry, barking dog. Okay, continuing. That's cool. The Iron Maiden shirt. I can't believe I just noticed that. They're definitely great musicians. Like, cannot complain about the musicianship. No critiques there, for sure. Let's talk about rock bass syndrome and how these guys don't seem to have it, even when they're dabbling in a genre that they don't normally play in. Like, the tendency would be to go towards the bass player. You're just playing the root notes for all of our chords, so you play the root notes, which you're gonna be here the whole time, basically. I mean, there obviously there's been more than just the one B chord, but like He's definitely doing that, but there's a little bit more play there, so you can tell that there's a bass player and not just really bottom heavy guitars. But he's also accenting with the drums. Like, he is exactly where he needs to be, and that I have a great appreciation for. Ooh, I think I just heard a little bit of ducking. Yeah, there's a weird little duck there. On the T. Why is that ducking? There's an audio duck issue. Compressor's doing too much, man. Right there, the T, the E, tur, like the vocal volume goes down. Why? It's not like there's anything exceptional going on at that point. There's nothing extra that would cause the duck. That's really weird. So you have these dueling leads here. And again, the tendency that what a lesser band would do is the bass player would just be sitting here. You know, he'd be sitting on these pentatonic notes. And probably wouldn't do much else, but he's definitely walking around. Even during this lead section, he's doing a fair bit of maneuvering, if you will. And I am here for it. It's funny too, because we have this weird mixed aesthetic as far as like the visual interpretation of the lyrics, because it's going back and forth from the skeletal dragon thing to like a...
Oh. Hello again.
Ah, let's not do that. Sorry, that was what I was using for to set up the audio. But yeah, so... The visuals, like you have, wait, let's see if we can get to what I'm talking about. We have this kind of like science fiction anime feel stuff to it, where the dragon is a crazy, like ship, right? Like right here, that's the dragon here. But then you get earlier in the video and we have that skeleton being put together right here. So that, and then we return to the skeletal dragon thing here at the end. Right there. I don't know. It's fun. I dig it. I'm here for it. This is definitely something I can appreciate. So yeah, that was that is King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard, and that is I dig it. I'm here for it. This is a fun band, man. I'm gonna have that. Uh, I'm going to have that kind of in my head a little bit. Anyway, that's the reactions. We're going to kill it. I got to give some puppies some medicine, and then we got another reaction that we're recording right now. So thank you very much for sticking around, nerds. What did you think of the track? Do you agree with some of my notes, the things that I heard? I never expect to hear ducking, and especially in something like this. So that kind of took me by surprise. But this is basically what I was expecting, but the best version of what I was expecting from these guys. So that's pretty awesome. If you aren't subscribed or anything yet, then please do subscribe. Generally on this channel, we do news. We talk about pop culture stuff. We talk about nerdy things like comic books and video games and TV shows and movies and all of that stuff. Star Wars. Subscribe if you want that kind of stuff. We do these reaction videos from time to time, and you can subscribe if you want that kind of stuff as well. Thank you very much, nerds, for joining. We'll see you in the next one. Before we go, always remember that if it's generally nerdy, it's probably here.